back and forth. Now, it's a great pleasure to have a guest today, Timothy Sisk. First of all, is I guess universally known as Tim Sisk. I don't think anyone calls you as Timothy, I suppose. Yeah. I don't know.
Only my mother when she was mad at me.
Of course. So Tim Sisk is a professor of international relations and comparative politics at the University of Denver in Colorado, where he's also the director of the PhD program in international studies, I suppose. Mm-hmm. And he has a lot of teaching and research experience and policy experience. I have no time to mention everything, but I just want to say he has published a number of books. His first book, if I remember correctly, was on South Africa, on the transition from apartheid to democracy. Then a book on Islam and democracy. Then several publications, including books on state building and various aspects of peace building. The latest one is on social cohesion and peace building. So he's a very well-known figure in the field. What is interesting about Tim's experience is also the fact that he has also a lot of policy advisory experience, and he has worked in many instances with the United Nations, and in particular with the UNDP, United Nations Development Program. And the lecture from tomorrow is actually part of a project that he developed together with UNDP. I'm sure I'm forgetting something, but one thing I need to say is that this class and tomorrow is part of a Jean Monnet chair that myself and the Osservatorio Balcani Caucaso here in Trento won last year. So we have some budget, some money from the European Commission to have guests and this type of meetings. So many thanks to the European Commission. Europe is useless. Always remember this when you go to vote. Because we have elections, you know, in the European Parliament elections are coming up. And the lecture today is Tim lecture is titled 21st Century Challenges, Crisis and Changes, When is Democracy Resilient? I am going to circulate a sign-up sheet. I'd like you to, the European Commission is asking us to keep track of people coming to these type of meetings. So please assign it and move it along to the next student. And at the end, we have 10 minutes perhaps or something like that for questions. We'll go until 4 o'clock because we're starting a little later. What else do I need to say? Thank you all for being here. Thank you, Tim. And the stage is yours.
Yeah, wonderful. Well, thank you, Roberto, for the very nice introduction. And there's one thing that Professor Bellani failed to mention, which is that years ago, I was on his committee for his dissertation, and that he's a product of the Corbell School of International Studies. So I asked one of my colleagues before I came over, a very senior colleague, Tom Ferrer, he's about in his 80s, I think. And he said, I'm going to visit Roberto Belloni in Trento. And he said, I remember Roberto very well. He said, I always wanted to be like him. And I'm like, okay, how is that, Tom? And he goes, well, he said he's smart, he's handsome, and he's young. So that was back in the day, right? But he's still, I think, smart, handsome, and relative to me, also young. So no, it's a real pleasure to be here. I remember very well Professor Bellani as a student, but also as a colleague for many years. So it's a real pleasure to be here and to be in this really lovely environment here in Trento. I'm happy to talk about on this particular topic, right? Democracy's challenges around the world, democratic crises like we see what today in Venezuela or in Sudan, right, where there are protests out on the street, Nicaragua, countries in crisis around democracy. And I've got a lot of material here. I suggested with Professor Bellani that I would share the PowerPoint with you too, right? In case there are like things that don't come across very well. Essentially, this notion of challenges, crises, and change, this work is part of some work that I did together with an intergovernmental organization based in Stockholm called International IDEA, the Institute for Democracy and Electoral Assistance. And they published in 2017 the first global survey from this organization. This is an intergovernmental organization. About 28 or 29 countries in the world are members of IDEA. And you can look them up online. They do everything on democracy promotion that you could think of, democracy building, you know, from constitution to women's involvement to democracy in conflict-affected countries, etc. So this was a big question. When is democracy resilient? Because as we've seen global trends, and I'll have plenty of global trends here for you, but global trends would suggest that democracy is in crisis worldwide. And the reasons why democracy is in crisis is because of the sort of 21st century challenges that we'll see. And I'll highlight some of those in a few moments. Here's where I'm going. I'm going to start with a couple of contemporary examples, things that I grabbed right out of today's newspaper and headlines. And then I'll go through what the PowerPoint involves and what the presentation involves. And I know myself very well. I'm going to run out of time, and I'm not going to be able to get through everything that I've prepared, but hopefully it will be enough for you to be able to go back and follow up on some of these things as you like. A little technical issue here, I think I can fix it. Okay, very good. Well, today in South Africa, we have the fifth general election since the end of apartheid. Apartheid ended in South Africa arguably 25 years ago when Nelson Mandela became a president of South Africa. And we see today that South Africa has all kinds of challenges. A new World Bank study came out yesterday, you know, really tied to the election. It says South Africa is the most unequal society in the world, right? And you can see here that it's also a very young country, and that many youth in South Africa are so disaffected with the political system, right? No jobs, poor opportunities, lots of crime, lots of corruption, that they're not even bothering to vote. Whereas just 25 years ago, many of them, especially those South Africans of color, they had no opportunity to vote at all. So their parents were, you know, voted for the first time 25 years ago in terms of liberation, but already much youth disaffection in South Africa. Similarly, we could see that, of course, democracy and very consolidated democracy, world's oldest democracy, is under crisis. We had this report came out yesterday. More than 450 former prosecutors said that they would have indicted President Trump for obstruction of justice were he not the President of the United States, which keeps him some immunity from this indictment, at least for now. So the U.S. democracy is absolutely in crisis at the moment, and I'd be happy to go through all of the ins and outs of the Mueller report if anybody is interested in these kinds of things. India, of course, is the world's largest democracy. Going to vote in India, and these elections unfold over 6 weeks because they're so huge, right? You can't just have one election day in India, but as we can see here, India has been facing the challenges of Hindu nationalism. Prime Minister Narendra Modi sort of playing the ethnic card, as we would say, in the literature. And as well, India, of course, has a huge amount of disaffection, all kinds of global challenges, including environmental challenges, food security challenges, and challenges of equality. And then finally, we have crises like we see in Venezuela, where just last week there was an effort to oust President Nicolas Maduro, but it wasn't successful. And That's because, well, the military, according to Mr. Juan Guaido, who is the leader of parliament, who claims to be the rightful president of Venezuela, said that these military elites with whom he was negotiating, right, to get rid of Mr. Maduro, backed out at the last moment, right? They got, we would say in English, cold feet, right? So these are just like in a given day, today, some of the headlines that would show out. Democracy around the world is in crisis. And it's facing a number of challenges, and these challenges come from within the country, often inequality, corruption, countries that rely on primary commodities, gold, diamonds, cocoa, agricultural products and things where there's lots of corruption, and they involve crises like we see in Venezuela, where there's lack of access to pharmaceuticals, food insecurity, as a result of these political crises. So when is democracy resilient? The first thing that I'd like to first of all go, well, let's step back and say, well, what is the global health check on democracy, right? If we take all of the best data that we have from these organizations that monitor and track human rights around the world, that track the quality of democracy, what is the state of the world's democracy? And is it in decline? The short answer is yes. And then I thought it was important to say, well, why does democracy matter as opposed to governance, right? Because we could say, well, look at a country like, context like Singapore or China, no democracy, right? But economic growth and people are perhaps more satisfied with aspects of their governance. But I'm gonna make the argument that democracy matters, right? And not just governments as if you could have a technocratic government and everybody would be happy, right? I'm for inclusivity, for voice, and this is something that's important. The third thing I thought we'd do is just look at some of these challenges, crisis, and change, right? And I'm sorry for that nomenclature. It actually comes from a UN report about 10 years ago on peace building and the state of the world, a high-level panel on crises, challenges, and change. I just like alliteration, so I thought it was a useful way. I'm probably not quite sure what I mean by change, but I do know what I mean by challenges and crises. So, and then this big question, when is democracy resilient? And it's a tough question because it's hard to know whether democracy is resilient until any given set of institutions have been challenged. Any kind of context, if you think about it, well, I'll get all wonky on you, all academic, right? It always involves a counterfactual. You know, if this crisis hadn't occurred, would democracy have survived anyway, etc.? It's a bit like the question of prevention and health, right? How do you know whether prevention works until after the fact? So, and then finally, from all of this pessimism about the global state of democracy, and there is pessimism out there about it, what can be done to design better democracies, to support human rights around the world, to protect journalists, right, who have been at the forefront of this democratic decline, etc. So that's where I'm going with the presentation. Like I said, I've got more material that I could possibly work through. It's kind of common for me. But nonetheless, I built in a couple of opportunities midway through the talk today for questions and comments and things like that. And if you're with me, by the way, don't hesitate to raise your hand if you don't understand something or you want more clarification, something like that. So, tracking democracy's decline. If I were to think, where is the best source I would go to, from a scholarly point of view, best methodology, most rigorous, most predictive, is the organization called VEDEM, the Varieties of Democracy Project. It's based out of Denmark, but involves scholars from around the world, right? And they just released their most recent report, 2019, called Democracy for All, see that they come out with this term, right? It's called autocraticization. Maybe we should all just like practice it, right? It's a bit like the old term when we work on the Balkans or you work on Northern Ireland or other contexts, we have this concept of consociationalism. And I had to practice saying it, I bet you did too. So autocraticization. So we used to talk about democratization, we still do talk about democratization, the process of moving from an authoritarian regime to a democracy, or from a civil war to a democracy, a bit like maybe Sierra Leone has gone through in the last 10 years or so. But this is the other way. This is when democracy is in retreat, when autocracy replaces democratic systems or begins to. And so they've come up with this word, autocraticization, now manifesting in a number of countries. So they have a very pessimistic view now of the global trend in democracy, that democracy is on the decline. Only 15% of the world's population lives in a country that is absent, okay, I'll throw some more jargon at you, absent what are called horizontal inequalities. That's where identity and economic opportunity overlap. So most of the world, almost 5 billion people, if you take the opposite, live in countries where there is systematic discrimination, exclusion, lack of economic opportunity for people based on their identity, right? So this is a very, or by gender, right? So these are types of marginalization. Here's what they say, intensified political exclusion now affects poor groups and countries for almost 2 billion people. So let me just put a little backstory here. It used to be, just a few years ago, 2-3 years ago, that this organization said, well, we're not sure whether democracy's in decline or not. It could just be like, so one day it's hot, one day it's cold, we don't know if there's climate change, but the long-term trends are now starting to be really quite clear, even from EDEM, which has been a more cautious organization. We go to other organizations like Human Rights Watch, right? Human Rights Watch, based in New York, is an annual survey of human rights around the world, and their 2019 report will also put you in a bad mood if you're an advocate of human rights. They say in 2018, this is from Freedom House, not Human Rights Watch, that's coming up, so that's the next slide, sorry. This data from Freedom House, which is based in New York, 68 countries saw declines in human rights, where only in 50 there were positive gains toward greater rights. Mm-hmm. So 24 governments around the world have targeted their opposition in exile. We think of the murder of the Saudi journalist Jamal Khashoggi in the consulate in Istanbul, but also Turkey itself, even though President Erdogan is very critical of the Khashoggi killing, has also targeted its opponents abroad, right? And so there have been some countries which have made improvements. We could talk about Angola, which is moving slowly, perhaps, toward more democratic freedoms. Armenia, where I have a good colleague, Lucinia Makarian, who's written me about the positive developments there. Ethiopia, where a new prime minister is now being more inclusive and seeking to democratize the country. Malaysia, Iraq. Iraq, interestingly, is a one context that's improving, right? But then there are others where things have gotten worse. And including Cameroon with its language conflict and ongoing crisis over language in the most recent election. Nicaragua, where there are protests in the streets against the ruling government, which itself came in, to power from the civil war, President Daniel Ortega. In Serbia, which has been listed as a backslider, and in Uganda, where if anybody knows the Uganda context well, right, the main opposition leader, anybody know how he became famous? I'm talking about Bobi Wine. Oh. He's a rap singer. He's like, I've watched his videos, and he's pretty good as a rapper. I mean, pretty good. I liked it, but he was recently imprisoned, right? He's just been let out of prison, but Uganda, you know, a lot of tension. So here you can see some of the graphics that have gone with the Freedom House report. Also, this is the one then from Human Rights Watch. And Human Rights Watch says, well, yeah, what we've seen is this backsliding, this democratic decline, but they have a slightly different story where they look around the world, like in Nicaragua, like in Sudan, like in Algeria, right? And they say, oh, we see resistance to this trend toward decline in democracy. It's civil society is responding, people out on the street. It is a dark time for human rights. And that the autocrats capture the headline. We had all of them around the campfire there. You didn't get to look at that very much, but it was a pretty nice little cartoon, right, with Trump there roasting marshmallows, and next to him is, all of the autocrats of the world. I'll have a list of those countries for you in just a moment. But what they're trying to say is that, yeah, there is a decline in democracy, but there's also what we may call, and I'll get back to this, societal resilience. That means that people don't accept this decline in democracy, and that they're turning out on the streets to oust autocrats very much, and sometimes they're successful. There have been victories, I think most recently, you know, we'll see how it turns out, but the protests against President Bashir, right, in Sudan may be an example of this. So there's the possibility that this excesses of autocratic rule, that we do see some resistance from society. So this is the moment where I give you what we call an ice cream headache. Does anybody know if you eat ice cream too fast, you get like a headache here? This is the data moment in the presentation. But these are long-term trends, as you can see. So shouldn't we be pessimistic about democracy? If you go back a 15-year trend, we would say, yeah. So over the last 15 years, democracy has declined. Historically, less so. This presents the data from Polity, which is another scholarly database that tracks the different types of regimes around the world. And we have democracies, we have autocracies, and then we have the worst piece of jargon in political science, which is called anocracy. So what is anocracy? It's an in-between kind of regime, right? Sometimes called competitive authoritarian regimes, sometimes called hybrid governance. And indeed, your dear professor edited a special volume of a journal on so-called hybrid peace governance, about these kind of regimes that sometimes I call them facade democracies, right? So they have elections, they pretend they're democratic, but at the end of the day, if you're an opposition figure, you feel the force of this so-called democracy. So they're in-between regimes. And we can see here briefly that that the blue line, which is democracy, has seen tremendous gain historically, and tremendous gain since 1990. Anocracies, middle regimes, hybrid regimes, partial democracies, we could call them, that stay about the same. Autocracies have gone down, but that red line suggests that, well, wait a minute, why isn't Professor Sis talking about authoritarian resilience, right? Like in North Korea or Saudi Arabia, these are very resilient regimes, right? So we see this sort of picture happening now, and particularly since 2010, which brings me to the next slide, which is the same data, just sort of spread out a little bit for you here. In other words, that this shows the patterns essentially since the end of World War II, but the dotted line there since the end of the Cold War. And what we see is that, yeah, there was tremendous gain in democracy after the end of the Cold War. We do have these autocratic, these sort of middle regimes, and again, the autocracies have declined to a certain extent, but many autocracies that are out there have been able to maintain themselves as autocracies. And I would include Egypt in this look, you know? So you sort of look here at the so-called Arab Spring, Arab Uprising around 2010, 2011. We saw some move toward democratization in Egypt, but then under President al-Sisi, the military comes back in, right, and reasserts control. So this is just some of the data on the global trends in governments. I'll go through the session on why democracy matters, and then I'll pause for a minute for any questions and comments, okay? So that's just a bit about the global trends. Should we be worried? Yes. Is democracy in decline? Most organizations agree that democracy globally has slipped. Is everything lost? Not necessarily, in the sense that some countries are making gains, even though there are greater losses than there are gains. There's a problem with that data. Let me just go back very quickly. There is a problem with this kind of data, right? Because what, it's not population adjusted, it's by country. So for every gain in a country like Ethiopia, there could be a loss in another country or a retraction in democracy like in the United States, but one is a much bigger kind of context than the other. So there's some methodological problems with this data when we go to sort of say, well, how many democracies? Because it's all based on the notion of one country equals one democracy. So it's not very fine-grained. The VDEM data, the variety of democracies data, tries to get around that with a much deeper measure. But that's starting to get technical on you. If anybody's interested in the technicalities of this, if you're working on a paper or you have your research project on and you want further, just let me know. I'd be happy to get further into it. Okay, why democracy matters? Well, democracy matters for both, to quote the famous development scholar, Amartya Sen, democracy matters for both intrinsic reasons, right, inherent reasons, and instrumental reasons. Because democracy may have good effects on two big issues, which is peace, both internal peace and international peace, and development, economic development. And particularly what I would call, being a good a colleague of many at UNDP, I would call inclusive development. So democracy matters because democratic governance contributes to peace. And I'll make this claim. It's disputed in the academic literature. We've done a lot of review. The mechanisms of how democracy contributes to peace are well evaluated. But basically, democracy can be defined as the eminent theorist Robert Dahl defined it, as a mutual security agreement. In other words, in a democracy, you agree to contest for power between different social forces, but that contesting for power should not mean that if you lose the election, you lose your life or you lose your freedom, right? Or you get the opposition locked up, you know, in jail, et cetera. So this is a democracy as a mutual security pact contributes to peace, but it also contributes to peace, in my view, through the association of democracy with human rights, right? Because democracy without human rights may not contribute so well to peace, particularly if democracy is nothing more than a majority rule kind of context, right? Which it doesn't have to be. So the United Nations, right, beginning in around 2013 as it prepared for the so-called Sustainable Development Goals, right, you remember from 2000, you guys are young, maybe you remember, I remember, Roberto remembers, from 2000 to 2015, right, we had the Millennium Development Goals, and there were eight of them. Now, between 2015 and 2030, the United Nations has its Sustainable Development Goals. And they included in the so-called SDGs, SDG 16, which says that if you want advances in women's education, you want better childhood nutrition, you want a better environment, that peaceful inclusive societies contribute to sustainable development. So the UN, because it's a collection of all these countries in the world, isn't very easily in its kind of SDG structure going to use the D word, right, democracy, because it's contentious, even though it's in many UN instruments. And so SDG 16, which is the penultimate sustainable development goal, says, look, if you want progress in all of these other good goals that we have, right, that ending of food insecurity in the world and these sorts of things, you need peaceful, inclusive societies. And this is another ice cream headache moment, but basically, the argument that I would like to make, and it's been made in a number of publications and research projects, is that governance and inclusive governance is at the center of security. It's at the center of more inclusivity, of greater capacity for governments, right? Capacity to deliver services, clean water, healthcare, education, etc. And that these things are all related, right? But that you can't make progress in development without having so-called good governance. Without good governance, and I would argue democratic governance, you have problems of insecurity and exclusion, systematic exclusion. So this is what we would call a systems model, meaning that it's all very complex and everything's related to everything else. But why democracy as opposed to governance, right? And this is an area that we could look and say, well, okay, there are arguments that we need good governance. And then there's some people that say, well, you just need good enough governance. If you have good enough governance, that's all you can hope for, especially in conflict-affected countries, in poorer countries, in the 60 so-called fragile states around the world. Have you talked about fragility, fragile states so much? So this fragile states idea is very prominent in policy and in the UN and other communities, which would say, look, there are maybe 60 to 80 countries around the world where either armed conflict, like Central African Republic, South Sudan, etc., undermine development. And there's also countries where there's high levels of armed violence, or criminal violence, like El Salvador, Honduras, where that also undermines development, right? People flee these countries. And so the idea is that these are so-called fragile or conflict-affected countries. But why inclusive democracy matters? The literature on whether democracy contributes to development is very contested. Academics have tried all kinds of different ways. You get two camps. Some say that democracy contributes to development. Others say that democracy has a little effect on development. Just because you have an election doesn't mean that all of a sudden everybody has a job, right? Ask the young people of South Africa. So the question is inclusive democracy. What does inclusive democracy do? I would say it's around the middle point of this slide. It contributes in six areas to better development outcomes. We see that where you have stronger civil society, you have better development outcomes. When you have political society, that is that you have agreement among the key political elites as to the rules of the game, right? When you have divided elites, like in Venezuela, you undermine democracy, or divided elites, like in Bosnia-Herzegovina. When you have a capable government that is as best as possible not corrupt. Right? And there's corruption across the board. There's corruption even in Norway, although much less than many other contexts, right? And so every year we have the annual Corruption Perceptions Index. Bureaucracy, the capability to have decent public policy, right? Public policies that are aimed at those who are less fortunate, right? At increasing incomes, providing jobs, providing health care, providing education. Economic society, a healthy economic factor, and an independent judiciary. And all of those things matter. Democracy's contribution to development is more long-term. That's my argument, and that's the finding of a lot of the literature here, that yeah, if you have an election tomorrow, it doesn't mean everybody has a job, but the longer a context is democratic and peaceful, the greater the degree of development over time. So on the flip side too, we could say, well, what are the costs of conflict, of violent conflict to development? And that area is really quite clear. When you have violent armed conflict, development suffers, and who suffers most? It's the poor, the marginalized, women, indigenous groups that are in society. So I believe democracy and inclusive democracy matters. We have to say, well, what is democracy, right? What is it? Because it means different things to different people. Right? We could have the rest of the seminar for the rest of this academic term around this question of what is democracy, right? But this representation is from International IDEA in Stockholm, and they've given this a lot of thought as to what democracy means. And you can see here that there are five big components, or so-called sub-dimensions of democracy, that they're measuring in their global state of democracy indices. And one is representative government, and that's what we typically think of apropos of democracy, inclusive elections, inclusive suffrage, political parties, clean elections, free and fair elections. Fundamental rights are essential, including, and this is where it's a bit more controversial perhaps, including social or economic rights in the definition of democracy. Because I've done a lot of work on South Africa, I started my career as a journalist in South Africa. And a lot of young people in South Africa would say, well, democracy doesn't give you a job. You can't eat democracy, right? And so this question of social rights and equality is important, that if you have political equality, but not economic equality or gender equality, then what is the meaningfulness of democracy? So I'm a good liberal democratic socialist. There's no doubt about it. I'm happy to wear that label until I go to the grave, whenever that may be, hopefully not soon. But nonetheless, it seems to me plausible to include social rights in the definition of democracy. Then we have the issues of accountability here too, around the media, around the judiciary, around parliaments, and checks on the executive. And that's where democracy is in crisis now in the United States, right? Where the Trump administration is trying to unconstitutionally prevent the Congress, the parliament, from exercising its rights and its obligation to oversee the executive's behavior. So when Trump has obstructed justice, and the Mueller report counts 10 instances of Trump obstructing justice, right? That this is a crisis for democracy in the United States. Impartial administration and participatory engagement. This gets at the question of civil society, participating in elections, in participation in referenda, voting, etc., and more importantly, local democracy, right? So this is what we mean by democracy. All boils down to political control and equality. So, doing not bad on time. That's part one and part two, right? It's a sense of world trends, and to a certain extent the policy context, right? The policy context would be from the UN, we're measuring whether progress toward SDG 16 can occur between 2015 and 2030. Initially, like all those other big measures, the progress is slow and uneven, and some countries have made better progress toward peaceful and inclusive societies than others. So before I go to part two, any comments or questions on the global context?
Can you just intervene to say,
yep.
Even if you feel uncomfortable with it, even in Italian, and then I can translate it.
But yes, please.
Please use the microphone, because otherwise I forgot to say we are recording this session. And no one will see your faces. Otherwise, I should have asked you for the what's it called, the privacy consent, etc. So the only one who's being recorded is me. I'm sorry, and him. But in order to hear your question, we need to use a microphone.
Okay, thank you. If it's okay, I would like to ask you like to comment on what's going on in Venezuela right now. Because, I mean, I believe that we can say that the situation is basically a mess. I mean, people are starving. The Bolivar, the currency of Venezuela, lost its value. People don't know how to pay for food. The government is even stopping humanitarian aid from coming into the country. And I mean, right now, it seems like the faction that's led by Juan Guaido is, some people are saying that they are losing momentum, so that they're coming to a stalemate and that maybe they can't go against Maduro. But I mean, what do you believe is going to happen? Also because, I mean, nobody likes Maduro, I believe, but also Juan Guaido was not elected as well. So I'm not sure that we can say that he is the legitimate president because he wasn't elected. So is this, I believe that this is an issue about democracy as well. So what is going to happen about democracy in Venezuela, maybe in the future? Are we going to find a solution to the situation? What is going to happen? Thank you.
Thank you. Fantastic question. Excellent question. And Venezuela represents the biggest crisis of democracy, I think, on the globe at the moment, where the mechanism that should have been in place to mediate between these factions in Venezuela, between the government of Maduro, who took over from Hugo Chavez, right, and the opposition, that ideally this would have been worked through the Organization of American States, right, which has its Santiago Declaration that would say, if there's a crisis of democracy in the Americas, that the organization, the OAS, has a mechanism to come in, to send a group of eminent persons to mediate, etc. That mechanism started to work, but what happened, in my view, is that the Trump administration has undermined this. So by encouraging Mr. Guaido to effectively try to get a coup d'etat against Mr. Maduro, that the Trump administration is undermining the norms and processes that have been built up slowly in Latin America to address these kinds of problems. So you're absolutely right. Your description of it was just right, that it's a terrible crisis at the moment, that the people of Venezuela are very much suffering, and we saw hundreds of thousands of people in the streets of Caracas over this weekend, right? Maybe we'll even have a picture of it coming up here. I'm not one to say, I'm very cautious about a prediction. In part because I was very wrong in 2016, so my wife will not really accept any kind of predictions from me anymore. Because I thought, oh no, don't worry, you know, Hillary Clinton will be fine. I had to take a long walk after that one, right? So I'm not sure I've fully recovered from that. So I'm not one to predict, but it's a very serious crisis. The other thing about Venezuela, I'll add briefly, is that the problem has become worse because it's become internationalized, right? So that now we have this as all of a sudden a litmus test, right? So the Russian influence is very strong. I mean, what interest do Russia have really in Venezuela? There's only one interest, and it's got three words. It's OIL, right? It's oil. And so, and same thing for Washington, that the interests are often so the more it's become an internationalized crisis, the worse it gets. And the only kind of way out I can see is to reactivate that OAS mechanism and to go back to a negotiation and try to have some sort of perhaps power sharing agreement that would provide for new elections, new constitution making. The United Nations has been emasculated in this context as well. So the UN role has also been undermined. So we're looking for mediators, Norway, Switzerland, someone, Costa Rica, who could come in and sort of mediate in this context. But it's a very difficult crisis, and it's been made worse by outsiders. Any other questions before we move along? Okay, maybe there'll be some more after this next section. So what are the kind of challenges, crises, and change that we see out there? I've tried to, in working with International IDEA on their 2017 publication, we tried to kind of come up with a typology, right? This is what academics do. We sort things into little boxes. We're just grown-up children, right? We try to make these little categories and put things into categories and separate them out, even though they're interrelated. The first challenge is very much around the politics, you know, that politics has become a matter of elite capture and rent seeking. That is, people get into politics because it's a way to wealth, right? And it's been a huge problem back to South Africa. You know, the former president of South Africa charged with 763 counts of corruption, right? Including the building of his $27 million home in Nkwamla in KwaZulu-Natal. And yet he's still there and has not been prosecuted for those alleged corruptions. Rent seeking has more to do with those kind of countries that rely on primary commodities, oil, minerals, agricultural products like cocoa. And we see that these kind of countries are very vulnerable to this elite capture. We could even bring in the term oligarchs here, right, as an example of this elite capture. And I found a nice little cartoon to this effect about corruption and organized crime. Okay. And so we also see the absence of political settlement. And you have very, very divided political elites, right? Like South Sudan, I would go there immediately, where they're divided, what, along ethnic lines in South Sudan as well. We see that this absence of a political settlement is a problem, a political challenge. Populism. Now, populism is a complicated topic. We could spend the rest of our seminar here, the rest of the few weeks, talking about what is populism. I do like the work of Kasmuda, by the way, on the populism issue. Very good scholar, writes on these things. But basically, the argument is elites who say, oh, I'm a person of the people, right? Donald Trump with his golf cart, he's a person of the people, right? I'm a person of the people, and I'm against all these other elites. But this is essentially what we would call demagoguery, right? And in some ways, Prime Minister Modi has been very effective in mobilizing people along nationalist lines, along religious lines in a multi-ethnic India, right? Hugely multi-ethnic India, yet here he is practicing yoga as a Hindu a practice, you know, in front of millions of people, making it a sort of more Hindu India, as opposed to the vision of a multicultural India, of an inclusive India, which was Gandhi's vision. And we'll see how the Indian elections come out. But populism, it's both of the left and of the right, right? And it's both religious populism, nationalistic populism. But to me, populism is a myth, right? It's a myth that somehow these elites somehow represent everyday people, or that everyday people, that their problems will be solved by the promises of these elites, right? That's also not the case. We find a populist regime that is actually delivered on economic or a social progress, that would be a thing. Inequality and extreme poverty remain serious barriers to democracy globally. And the biggest is inequality, which is growing in the world, could read some of the most recent reports. It was in 2013 that the World Bank finally discovered inequality as a major global issue in their World Development Report. But at the same time, we see inequality and extreme poverty. There is a global youth crisis. For those who may be tomorrow in the lecture, it's a completely different topic. But I'm going to talk about sport and politics tomorrow. And we can see that there's a global youth crisis, absence of jobs, etc. Youth unemployment in South Africa. Anybody know what the estimate of youth unemployment is in South Africa? Over 60% youth unemployment. No jobs. How do you even get to a job? Maybe you get an interview, but you don't have any money to even be able to get to the interview because it costs money to get transport to the interview. I saw a very nice a story on BBC yesterday. I think I had it on my first slide, actually. If you read that, you'll see, youth are, there's a youth crisis globally. Influence of money in politics. This is the biggest problem in the United States. We could spend the rest of the term talking about the problem of money in politics in the United States. Gender discrimination. Migration, multiculturalism, and social polarization. Now, personally, I would say migration is not the challenge. Migration has been a fact of human history ever since whenever, right? Ever since Lucy, the fossil, right? Lucy, and before her, I understand. But nonetheless, it's how societies react and deal with migration that's it's problematic. It leads to social polarization. In that IDEA publication, 2017, Global State of Democracy, there's a fantastic chapter on multiculturalism written by Natalie Ibe, an Austrian colleague, and others on that project. Armed violence, gangs, crime as a problem, and of course ethnic fragmentation and ethnic differences, something I'll talk about. So I thought I would spend just a moment on elections, and this is probably where I have too much material because I'm a nerd on elections. You know the term nerd? I'm a nerd when it comes to elections. Electoral systems, proportional representation, single transferable vote. Yeah, I could spend the rest of the day talking about elections. Elections are both essential to democracy and a challenge for democracy. Because elections are sometimes accompanied by political violence, right? If I grabbed a few headlines, including a couple that are more recently about election-related violence. And this is a huge problem globally about contentious elections. But elections are, again, they're two-sided coin, voice and violence. More than 25% of elections that occur around the world are accompanied by some degree of political violence. And I'll have a slide in a moment as to why. But often these are in those partial democracies, right? And we could see from Zimbabwe, Guyana. Guyana is a country that had historical election-related violence, less contemporary now. The most recent elections in Democratic Republic of Congo, or even under conditions of referenda. So we could, this is a theory moment, I should probably skip this, but there's a lot of ways to look at elections, right? From an economic perspective, from a political or cultural perspective, from the institutions, like is it going to be run under a proportional system or is it winner take all, right? So these are challenges for democracy. Anybody know the proportion of the vote by which Donald Trump was elected president of the United States? The proportion of the vote. Less than 50%, 43%, roughly 43% of voters. About 3 million votes less than Hillary Clinton, but because of the rules of the game, he wins. And then enough said about that. So these are some of the key issues around elections. I'll just skip that kind of thing. This is what I call the elections pizza. My colleagues who developed it don't really like that, but we're here in Italy. I love pizza. Who doesn't love pizza? Well, my mom never liked pizza. I never understood why she didn't like pizza. But it's a little hard to read, but you can see elections are not just about the day of voting. They're about the legal framework. They're about the registration of voters. They're about external observers, about counting, about who conducts the elections, all kinds of issues around elections. We ask, is democracy resilient? Well, it depends. Do elections actually make things worse or make things better? Some scholars, very big name scholars, would say elections are conflict inducing. They lead to violence. There's a fantastic book out there. I'm sure Professor Belloni knows it, written by Jack Snyder. It's mostly on the Balkans. It's titled From Voting to Violence, right? As if elections lead automatically to violence. I've done a lot of work on elections. I would say, no, they don't cause violence, but they amplify, right? They make more serious all of the social, economic, political challenges within society, right? They turn up the heat on elections. And often you could see from this example from the Philippines, right, that they are associated with often with violence. Local elections in the Philippines, I had a colleague who did a study. She looked at longitudinal analysis of local elections in the Philippines. Every time there's a cycle of elections in the Philippines, approximately 124 fatalities for local elections, right? Not for national elections, which can be even more so. So what is election-related violence? We see violence to undermine the process of elections, and violence to affect the outcomes of elections. And we could see that why elections are violent, you know, why they become a difficult in many contexts. And it's because people may vote along ethnic or religious lines. That's often a concern. That's, I think, what we've seen happening in the United States, is that more and more people vote identity rather than interest. It's a worrying trend. That often in many contexts, this is about who controls power at the local level. My most important aspect for those who are interested is the actual system of elections. So I'll put it out there that I think elections that are run on a majority rule basis, winner take all, are more prone to violence than those run under systems of proportional representation. But can I go around and change everybody's election laws all around the world? No. So this is a big problem. It's an important one to keep in mind that the electoral system affects a lot. And we can see different types of elections. South Africa today, they're going into parliamentary elections, but this also has the effect of choosing the president. Different types, and we could see even referenda, the so-called legal referendum in Catalonia, yet another example. So we could also say, well, elections are violent because of the underlying challenges within society, right? The so-called root causes, that you have poor governance, you have people living in informal settlements. All the flags here, this is all of the political party symbols of ethnic political parties in Myanmar. So you think about, oh, Myanmar is one of our cases, you know, with movement from autocratic regime. Aung San Suu Kyi wins the Nobel Prize, right? Moves to some sort of democracy. Well, not so fast, right? Because of the ways in which ethnicity permeates the society in Myanmar. So just a sense of some of those challenges. And then there's also the fact that political elite tries to steal elections and engage in fraud and try to manipulate electoral processes. So the fact in Turkey that they're going back to try to rerun the elections, right, in Istanbul is a bit like saying, okay, we had a nice football match, soccer, whatever, our team lost, but we weren't very happy about that, so we're going to play that match again on Sunday, right? I was like, well, that's not exactly a fair game, but that's exactly what's happening in Turkey. So that's a lot about, the final slide here is, well, who's perpetrating this election-related violence, right? Well, we could see that political parties sometimes have military wings or armed militias with them, right? Many politicians around the world have their sort of group of bodyguards and their armed actors that protect them, but then those are the people too that go out and target opposition figures, target journalists, target civil society, anyone that they don't like. Police, army units, and special intelligence services often involved with election-related violence. And then we also have the problems of rebel factions, militias, vigilante groups, et cetera. So I've done some work, and I'd be happy to point anybody to some work about how do we prevent a conflict during elections. That's just one element of democracy, one element, but it's a very important one. Questions on challenges, crises, elections? It's your chance, you have an elections nerd. Anything you ever wanted to know about elections?
Hi, so I'm from Bangladesh, and we recently had, as you know, you've also covered it in your slides, we had our elections in 31st December, and the Prime Minister, Awami League, the ruling government, won by 96% of the vote, so which is kind of abnormal if you truly believe in democracy. And then the opposition parties, they revolted, saying that you can't win by 96%, and it's clearly unfair. So in such cases, although the opposition governments claim for another re-elections, it rarely ever happens. So in such circumstances, what do you suggest the common public to do? Like, Or should we just accept it that it's going to be unfair and there's nothing we can do about it?
Right, that's a very good question and a very difficult one to answer. You're absolutely right about Bangladesh and the concern around electoral integrity. It's been a long-standing issue in Bangladesh, and you know more about Bangladesh and Alzheimer's, right? But it's true, the two political parties have been at odds. They're both in the club, as I understand, right? And they've been at odds for years. I believe the opposition boycotted those elections. And either was there a formal boycott? So she couldn't run. So to me, I think that's right. Anytime you see sort of 96% on an election outcome, not even Saddam Hussein got that high. You know, once they had elections in Iraq under Saddam Hussein and who had claimed 97%. No, typically when governments try to steal elections, they prefer to come in around 60 or 62% so that it's believable. This was always the case in Zimbabwe. It's like, oh, the government won by 64%. Sometimes I think they come up with that number and then run an election, right? But so what the average citizen can do, this is a very good question, because to go out and protest is very risky for your life. And who wants their kids out on the street, you know, protesting? What parents, right? In South Asia, unlike in Venezuela, there's not a strong regional organization. Now, at best, we would have the ASEAN Parliamentary Forum or something like that. The SARC is not much in this regard. So there's where we look maybe to the United Nations, and I think this is one area where there needs to be a strengthening of the United Nations. I'll have this on a slide, conclusion slide, in just a moment, to say one of the areas that should be further developed is to have an international mechanism to be able to respond to these political crises, right, where you would have then a UN fact-finding, UN investigation, and eventually some kind of reaction to non-compliance. But when I walked in, I saw a sign on Professor Belloni's door that said, a Center for Democracy and Global Governance. This is the area of global governance which is wholly underdeveloped. If you have a crisis in Cote d'Ivoire, in Bangladesh, in Cameroon, what kind of global automatic response mechanism is out there? And there's not a good one. So unfortunately, the people do suffer, and I think that's the problem. In the case of Bangladesh is a very good example. I wish I had a magic bullet for that one, or a magic solution. Bullet's probably not the word. Magic solution for that, but it is a very difficult problem, and I think that's exactly how many people in the United States felt about 2016, even though that was relatively free and fair. Now we know from the Mueller report the extent of Russian interference in the election. You'll recall that right after the election, we had the Women's March in Washington, D.C., where we had 2 million women out on the street. It didn't change things, but it sent a signal. I'm so proud of our daughter was out there. Okay, I'll move on in the interest of time, but we're still doing okay on time. If anybody has any questions still on these sort of challenges or crises in the list. Well, now I'll move to the actual topic of the lecture today, now that we're an hour into it, okay? Which is, you know, why this association of democracy and resilience? And I love Kofi Annan. I miss Kofi Annan. I wish we had more people like the former Secretary General of the UN. But he gave a lecture in 2001. He said, look, you know, at the end of the day, politics is about power. And there's really only one way to resolve these kind of social conflicts. And it's through peaceful processes. And those peaceful processes are democracy. And it's the only solution that I know of, short of some sort of utopian solution, which I'd be happy to chat about the utopian literature on democracy, of which there is a good literature. But in the real world, democracy is what we've got to manage issues under conditions of mutual trust, and peacefully. And we know that countries that have been long-standing democracies, right, are more peaceful. Authoritarian regimes can't be peaceful, but it's an imposed peace, right? It's an imposed peace, and often authoritarian regimes have peace on their own terms. In other words, if we think about China, the peaceful authoritarian regime, right, providing economic growth. We get movies, Crazy Rich Asians, and this kind of thing coming out. China has lifted more than 500 million people out of poverty in the last 20 years, right? But there's a backstory about China, right, which is the Uyghur internment camps in Western China, where the UN says there are more than 2 million people interred, detained because of their identity, their ethnic and religious identity. So what kind of world do we want to live in? A messy democracy, or one in which the government can put in detention camps what some people say is up to 3 million people in these re-education camps, right? So for me, the question of autocracy as an alternative, not for my preference. But we know that the process of getting to from one to the other, this shows, by the way, what it shows is the chart shows, I'm sorry, you couldn't read, I should have explained it, huh? It's that in the middle, this is the annual count of so-called political instability events. So riots, assassinations, that sort of thing. In these in-between regimes, it becomes very sketchy. So we're trying to say, well, when is democracy resilience, right? We have to define resilience, and in this IDEA publication, which I was very fortunate to be involved, we looked around at all of the international organizations that had used the resilience concept. That's basically all of them. right? We think of UN Environment Program, International Organization for Migration, UNICEF for Children, all talk about resilience in different kind of ways, but resilience is about flexibility, to absorb and manage stress or pressure, to think about overcoming challenges and crises. If you're resilient, you can overcome a crisis or a challenge or a problem. I missed a train yesterday because it was one of them was late, and you think, okay, I can handle this, and then I'll get the next one. You can be sort of resilient in the face of bad things happening. It's a really bad example, but there are others, I guess, in terms of personal resilience, right? Innovation is another aspect of resilience. And then we came up with the idea that a resilient democracy is one that has these attributes, right? Of flexibility, recovery, adaptation, and innovation. Is democracy resilient? Well, there are a lot of arguments that democracy is resilient. And here's my view, that it's not inherent in democratic systems that they can be resilient. We can see contexts or situations of a country that had a prior experience with democracy, but then democracy has failed and been replaced by a military regime. I go back historically to think about Brazil, right, which was a democracy before the dirty wars of the 1980s, and is now back to a democracy, albeit one with all these challenges that we've talked about. When we talk about democracy and resilience, it's like capacity to cope, right? Capacity to deal with these challenges, to deal with crises, to get over them. So I would say democracy can be resilient, but it's not a given thing. In the academic literature, this is where I'll get kind of theory on you, probably the last theory slide for you, but there's two lines of arguments. One would say, look, democracy has built into it all of these self-correction mechanisms, right? If the president steals from the treasury, there's a mechanism by which there's investigation and a response. If an election is not free and fair, there's opportunity to improve it for the next round, etc. So example of this sort of democracy's ability to self-correct, maybe some of the features built into the new constitution of South Africa was adopted in 1996. That has this office of special prosecutor to investigate corruption, right? And although that's a very long story about how that's occurred, we did see the president charged with crimes, and we do see what's called at the current moment a huge commission on state capture, right? That's trying to look and see how did the government of Jacob Zuma capture the state, and how that, in a way, we might see South Africa as an example of this self-correction mechanism. The other argument is what causes democracy to be resilient is that people react, like the Human Rights Watch group was saying, that what we're seeing is maybe a counter-reaction from civil society, from people in the street, from international actors to say, no, we don't accept this decline in democracy in our context. And so we could look at civil society, et cetera, and including the role of outside actors. So the norm, the sort of one example of this I would bring out is that, you know, more and more the attitude, that the historical attitude that politics and governance is basically a game for old men, right? Historically, that's the case, that we see that since 1988, with the adoption of the Convention on Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, that there's been an increasing participation of women in governance globally. And if you're interested in this, I would point you to the work of the Interparliamentary Union that sits in Geneva, where they track the number of women in parliament around the world. We can see that although very slow progress, And just because you have more women doesn't necessarily mean you have better outcomes for women. That's ideal, but we see increasing women's participation. So this idea that modernity, you know, rising income, education, urbanization contributes to democracy, all those things are moving in the right direction. So where do we look for resilience, right? Where do we look for resilience in democracies? We look for human rights and human rights actors, those like reporters, who are out there trying to track, you know, every time there's a murder of a journalist. There was a murder of a journalist last week in Mexico on the day before International Press Freedom Day, right? So the very day before, right? So we look for human rights activists. We look for, you know, areas where democracy, if the national politics are poisoned, can local democracy, you know, give a counter to that. We often see ruling regimes, like the Erdogan government in Turkey, which loses elections in their own capitals, right? Happened in South Africa, happens in the United States, happened in Turkey. So we are also focusing on security sector, policing, contexts like Colombia or Nepal, where you see former rebels, former insurgents now involved in government, right? Elections, we dealt in that, against civil society, and greater state capacity. So this is the one slide I probably should have spent the whole time today on, so I apologize for that. This is like, okay, unpacking this concept of democracy's resilience. At first we could say, well, democracy is resilient when you have a citizens committed to democracy, and citizens that are willing to do like a colleague from Bangladesh suggests, right, which is public mobilization. My friend and colleague, Erica Chenoweth, is anybody familiar with her work? Erica Chenoweth? She's at Harvard. She does some of the best work globally on citizen movements, social movements around the world. Tracks the number of protests and people on the streets. You will be amazed to see on any given day how many places around the world we see this resilient citizens, people out on the street demanding an end to corruption, demanding an end to a capture. Just over the weekend, right, we saw massive protests in Venezuela, in Sudan, and Algeria. Just one weekend, last weekend, huge protests, tens of thousands of people. Resilient institutions, right? When you have a division of power within government, and institutions can respond to these efforts to grab power or to claim or corruption. Resilient societies, when you have a vigorous press, right? When you have a civil society. Now, I had to put civil society in quotation marks because I'm here in Professor Belloni's classroom, right? Because his work has been fantastic to say, look, not all organizations that are part of civil society are necessarily civil. And some of the work I've worked on this, a paper actually, I cited your work that I was to say, look, if you want healthy civil society needs to cross-cut lines of identity. It's okay to have some civil society, which is identity-based, maybe indigenous groups that advocate for their rights, etc. But at the end of the day, going back to some of the pioneering work on social capital, we find that those civil society organizations that cross-cut, right, that bring together people from different types of identities, different class dynamics, different regional dynamics, are more protective of democracy and even more facilitative of peace, I would argue. So-called bridging civil society as opposed to bonding civil society. Again, out of the social capital literature, and your professor is a global expert on it, so you can ask him all the tough questions about civil society, right? Designing resilience, is it possible for us to sit back and think about Are there other ways to elect a president other than the way the United States has at the moment, which is called the Electoral College? And it explains why you can get a person, why you can get a deviance from the popular vote and the actual electoral outcome. It's because of those institutions, right? Can you design a democracy that drives politics toward the center, toward moderation and inclusivity, as opposed to designing a democracy where the way you get elected is to play to your core supporters, right? And this leads to all kinds of dangers. So this is a long-standing area in the literature. Again, Professor Belloni very well sensitized to this literature. As academics, we could sit here and we could say, okay, we're going to design a beautiful democracy. We're going to revisit democracy in the United States and presidential elections. There's a very good book that just came out on that, by the way. And we could think of all kinds of ways to have so-called like ranked choice voting, where rather than one vote, you get to rank your candidates to say, well, I really like Hillary Clinton, but my second choice is actually Kamala Harris or someone else, you know? So you can rank your choices, and then the candidates can trade back and forth, so-called preference-based voting. See, I told you I was an elections nerd, right? But yeah, we could think through different ways to design more resilient systems, but there's a problem. Academics can design beautiful systems that would say, yeah, this would be more fair, this would encourage people to vote, this would drive politics toward the center, people might campaign for office by appealing to people outside of their own identity group or their own class or their own region. You might have candidates that would appeal more to women or appeal more to try to get votes from other groups, etc. But how do you get those adopted? That's the question. In some cases, and I'll throw it out there, the case of Nepal, does anybody know democratization in Nepal very much? Nepal had a civil war, had a peace agreement in 2006, had two rounds of constitution making. The new Nepali constitution came out in 2015. And it's an example of a country that looked all around the world and came up with a bunch of new ways to redesign its democracy, to bring in more inclusivity from indigenous peoples, from women, from those in the lower ranks of the Hindu caste system, Dalits and other castes. And so Nepal's not a perfect democracy. In fact, it's a very messy democracy. But they're trying to design a democracy that will be more resilient because they know that the prior experience with democracy led to civil war, and that this is a way to design a more resilient system. And finally, we need better global and regional frameworks. And I think this is what's missing in South Asia. It's what's missing in much of Southeast Asia. And even in places where we have good mechanisms for responding to these crises, like the Organization of American States, we find that they're not strong enough. So I think really improving global governance and responses, like responding to places where there are attacks on journalists, right? And addressing those kinds of issues, right? Saudi Arabia, what consequences has it faced from the killing of Jamal Khashoggi? I don't see it. Anybody else see it? Not really. We'll see what happens with MBS. The president goes by initials. Mexico, the president goes by initials too, right? AMLO. This Manuel Luis Obrador, a very promising new president in Mexico, albeit not without problems. But you can see that Mexico has serious problems with the safety of journalists otherwise. But you know, what kind of global mechanism is there? So let me just finish up. I'll skip this slide. Because I think I'm running out of time. I'm going to be sure to get any more questions, and I have a couple more to go. But if anybody's interested in, well, how does a society that's had ethnic conflict around elections, does it design a democracy to address ethnic conflict, much of which was exacerbated by social media, right? It's easy to be a radical on social media because you don't have to face anybody in person, right? And they have huge problems with social media and ethnic conflict in Kenya. Well, they designed a commission on social cohesion. And social cohesion is the topic for tomorrow, by the way. But the NCIC monitors social media. They try to find who's engaging in hate speech. And there are legal penalties for engaging in ethnic hate speech on social media in Kenya. So democracies can recover from the 2007-2008 election violence. They can come up with new mechanisms to protect democracy. Again, Kenya's not a perfect democracy. The last round of elections also had ethnic-based tensions. But after the election, the loser, Mr. Odinga and Mr. Kenyatta, the president came out and had like a public handshake, you know, to say, look, we don't want ethnicity to destroy our society. So what should we be doing? And this is a very good question around contexts like Bangladesh. The first is we need better institutions. I don't think any of us should be happy. I'm not happy with the institutions in the United States. And many countries need to engage in constitutional and legal reform and to rethink some of their practices. Like, does it really make sense in a context like Brexit or Catalonia to have a winner-take-all referendum on such a key issue like sovereignty? Is that really a good idea? It's only a good idea if you know the outcome in advance, right? Like maybe Timor-Leste or others. But otherwise, sovereignty referenda, not a good idea. So thinking better about institutions and demanding institutional reform, I think, is an important aspect. Protecting rights, I mean, this is for me the most important thing. Democracy is meaningless without human rights. And thus, it's around civic education, right? Teaching people to know their rights, to advocate for their rights, protecting the press. Sorry, that's a little mistake on my slide there. The third one should be, around promoting, protecting civil society, human rights defenders, right? And this needs to be an area of global governance and strengthening. And then exactly as suggested, we have a political crisis or a stolen election, a fake election, that some kind of global mechanism for responding, including deployment of UN special political mission. Not a class on the UN, I don't think. But if it were, I'd be happy to talk about will we have peacekeeping operations. But now the UN is increasingly deploying teams of civilians in these environments. Like in Colombia, there's no peacekeeping mission in Colombia to try to seal the Havana Agreement. Instead, what there is a strong UN presence. But it's men and women in suits, not even in suits, most of them are wearing jeans, right, which is cool, to be there to help reintegrate ex-combatants, to work on parliamentary strengthening, protect civil society, et cetera. And for me, the answer lies in regional organizations. So I do appreciate that question on Bangladesh, because in some areas, like in Europe, with the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, the OSCE, there's a stronger regional organization. In the Americas, the OAS. But in contexts like South Asia, East Asia, there are weaker regional organizations. Central Asia, very weak regional organizations. So this is an area I think is important. And this is my last slide. Okay, because we're almost out of time. Which is implications for bottom-up resilience. If we want to think about resilient democracy, we can't operate at the level of 36,000 feet saying, okay, I'd like to rewrite the U.S. Constitution. That seems like a very difficult hurdle to cement. So the way to approach this, in my view, is a bottom-up approach to resilience. and to resilience and democracy, and that is empowerment of youth and addressing the global youth challenge, and addressing the challenge of youth unemployment globally. I don't know if anybody read, it came out last week, it's called the Global Emotions Report. Anybody see that? The Global Emotions Report. It came out from Gallup, which does this sort of public opinion surveys around the world, and their big finding, people are angry, depressed, and sad, right? Everybody is in a funk globally, right? That's an idiom we would say. In a funk means kind of bad mood, right? You know, woke up on the wrong side of the bed sort of thing. And it's in part because of all of these sort of challenges. Modernity is difficult. Really working on bottom-up empowerment of those who have been historically marginalized. Youth employment is critical. Youth attitudes, engaging in investing in education systems. If you want democracy to be resilient, you have to have a resilient population. Dealing with some of these structural inequalities, systemic inequalities that we see globally. So empowerment is a critical aspect of it. So in a way, back to that systems theory, if you want resilient democracy, you've really got to work on those who have been most historically marginalized, who have little access, a bottom-up empowerment approach. We're back to development in many ways. Second is greater participation and more consensus-based government. And so that's a big issue too about, does democracy always mean 50.001%? Doesn't have to mean that. There are ways to design democracy, Professor Bologna knows these well as well, about ways to have more consensus-oriented politics. And my little vignette about ranked choice voting is just one example of ways to have a more democratic system that's designed to promote consensus rather than political tribalism, which is often the problem. Improving access to justice. There are also findings globally that most people feel that they don't have a way to access legal systems, have grievances redressed, to be able to feel justice. So my colleague next door to me at home, Marie Berry, she does work on women in post-conflict countries. One of her findings is that after war, we see high rates of women's participation in parliament. And that would include Rwanda, South Africa, et cetera, and now increasingly in Colombia. But what she's also found is that women don't feel secure in these environments. There may be more women in parliament, but every day people don't feel secure. Women and girls don't feel secure in their own society. And that's a matter of community security and of justice. So just having women in parliament isn't enough. This is bottom-up resilience, right? Improving security for women and girls, I think, is a critical global issue. Accountability is yet another issue, too. We can think about old-style accountability, right, which would be that the parliament is supposed to keep the executive in check. But if the same party controls parliament, controls executive, not a lot of accountability. So there's a lot of work now on social accountability. Maybe this is a solution in Bangladesh, not a solution, but an option, where people can rate the quality of governance with mobile apps and other things. I could point you to some work on so-called social accountability. And then finally, we are back to civil society and bridging civil society and informal institutions and leaders. That is not making democracy only about formal processes, but democracy from the bottom up at the local level, at the community level. And I'm not romantic about local democracy. It can be just as messy and problematic. But the more layers you have, the more institutions, the more arenas for bargaining, negotiation, compromising society, the more resilient that society will be. I threw on this one about democratic innovation in world megacities, because that's the future of the world, is big cities. More than half of the people around the world today live in big cities. And I think we've got to kind of rethink this idea that, oh, if we're tracking democracy around the world, it's only about which country, right, made a little gain or made a little loss. We've really got to fine-tune our ability to measure and think about democracy by looking at global democracy in cities. So with that, that's the end of the presentation. But I'd be very happy to take questions now or informally as well as we get going.
Earlier, you mentioned social rights and social justice. And do you think that one of the reasons for the decline of democracy is also the death of welfare systems, for example, in Europe? And do you think that there can be resilience without a welfare state? Or to talk about resilience, we also have to reintroduce a welfare system, social system, to support the population?
It's a very good question. I'll repeat it for those who maybe didn't hear it. But the question is whether you can have a kind of a resilient democracy without systems of social justice. And I would say no, actually, that in fact, my view, and this is not an ideological position, I hope, this is based on, you know, kind of 35 years of research and learning in this area, that society in general is only as good off as the least fortunate person in that society. That you take a context like Brazil or South Africa or Honduras or El Salvador, is a context I know well, where you have these gross inequalities, right? You see the pictures from space of a South African city, like you've got Sandton, one of the richest square miles in Africa, right next to Alexandria, this huge informal shantytown settlement. How one expects democracy to work in that kind of situation. Those countries that have such high inequality, as we've seen in Brazil, and to a certain extent in South Africa, are highly vulnerable to populism and to populist movements. And populism mobilizes on the grievance without providing the true solution. So my view is that while not every country has to become Sweden, right, with a high degree of social welfare, those countries that fail to pay attention to the least fortunate in society and to address the human security of those who are impoverished, of indigenous peoples, of historically disadvantaged minorities, know those are very vulnerable to conflict, to crisis, absolutely. That's a good question.
We have time maybe for one more.
So I know that you just spoke about bottom-up resilience, but I would like to know your opinion about top-down resilience. I'm thinking specifically about the last security strategy of the European Union, which is based precisely on the concept of resilience. And so I would like to know if you think that an approach like the UN could be successful. Thanks.
Thank you. That's a very good question. I know less about the European Union, its role in, you know, fostering certain types of resilience norms, but I do know about the UN, and so I could speak to the idea that, okay, the UN is a machine that sort of produces global norms of inclusivity, of poverty eradication, of living together. Maybe some of you noted the UN conference last week that happened in Baku in Azerbaijan, the World Alliance of Civilization. And they're trying to prevent hate speech, trying to prevent the sort of kind of divisions that we see globally. So they produce all of these norms, right? These values that we should live together, we should have more women involved, all of those sustainable development goals. I'm like, well, does this actually have an effect at the local level? I did a 2-year research project. I that's the kind of typical notion, this is academic term, norm diffusion. What we found was that the logic works a little bit differently. Top down, the UN puts out all of these norms. Safe cities is an example of that. There's a lot of work on urban security, or women's participation again, et cetera, early childhood education. The found is that local organizations have done extremely well not to just grab the norms from the UN and advocate for them, but to interpret them and modify them to their own context. So yes, I think the top-down part, it's a combination of putting it out there globally that elections should be held with integrity, right? And then when there's an electoral process that doesn't happen with integrity, that there's a mechanism too for local actors to say, no, our government has to abide by these international norms. So I see it as a complementary approach, that you need that top-down process as well as a bottom-up to make things better.
Well, unfortunately, we have to stop here because there is another class in a few minutes. I'd like to thank very much Professor Timothy Sisk for the presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you also for coming today. Let me remind you that the conversation continues tomorrow, and we'll try to start closer to 2 this time. It was also we came just a couple of minutes later, perhaps. And if you have the sign-up sheet, if you have not signed the sign-up sheet, please do so. And I think someone has it in the back. If you can bring it to the front, please. And if you have not signed it, if you can come to sign it. Final point, let me remind you that we have class also on Friday morning. To be honest, I don't remember whether we have class at 9 with international relations and 11 state and nation building or vice versa. So state and nation building at 9 and international relations at 11. But just to remind you, a couple of days in advance. Thank you. No, this is international. Got it. State and nation building is tomorrow here at 2, like today. Same as today, tomorrow.